All right, and we're official. I'm still letting a couple folks in here, but welcome everyone. My name is Nate Wright. I'm one of the support counselors here with COVID Support Vermont. And we are so grateful to welcome the Green Mountain Club and Lauren Couriers, the volunteer and education coordinator, to do this really wonderful presentation all about exploring Vermont and hiking. And this is just, I know I'm really looking forward to learning some things today. Just really quickly, if you aren't familiar with COVID Support Vermont, I trust many of you are, but we're funded through a FEMA grant and Vermont's Department of Emergency Management and Mental Health, and administered by Vermont Care Partners, which is that statewide network. Here are 16 nonprofit community-based agencies that provide mental health support, substance use, and intellectual and developmental disability services supports, among other things. It's just wonderful to get to know those organizations in your area. And our goal here at COVID Support Vermont is to support support folks going through this pandemic experience, and also providing ideas about wellness and how to cope and also to practice wellness during this time. And one of the great things that you can do for your wellness, both physically, mentally, and full spectrum, is to get outside and to go hiking and explore nature with yourself, with your family, with your friends. So I'm going to turn it over to Lauren, and he's going to tell us all about how to do that. And really, really looking forward to this. So Lauren, go ahead and take it away. Just a note, you're not able to unmute yourself, but if you have questions, you can reach out in the chat. And I know Lauren's given you some info in the chat there as well. Yeah, cool. All right, here we go.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Nate. Thanks for inviting us to do this and for all the work that COVID Support Vermont has done. It's been a long 16 months or whatever it is, but having organizations in Vermont like you that help people get through this stuff is really important, so we appreciate it. And hiking is one great way to get through it. Last year, if we didn't have the Long Trail, if we didn't have Vermont State Parks and all of our local towns, and I don't know where I would have been all summer. So it's a good opportunity to get out there right now, especially, and that's what we'll talk a little bit about this afternoon. If you all could please share with me in the chat box where you're joining from, and maybe what are your goals for this workshop. It's really nice to get an idea of what you out there on the computer are looking for from this. I've taught this a bunch of times. Hiking for me is kind of a second nature, but it's not like that for everybody. And it wasn't always like that for me. So it's nice to know where you're at right now so I can cater this in a specific way. That picture right there is a picture of the Long Trail somewhere in the state of Vermont, a big open forest. And we'll talk a lot about the Long Trail, the Green Mountain Club, as we get on. Really quick agenda overview. Don't look at this. I was saying to Nate, I changed the agenda a little bit. It's not very organized, but we'll talk about the Green Mountain Club, about me a little bit, what qualifies me to maybe lead this, maybe qualifies me, benefits of hiking, what it means to get in shape, and how to be physically ready for a hike, where you can go hiking in the state, and then some of the nitty gritty stuff about preparing for a hike, weather, food and water, layers, 10 essentials is a thing that we'll talk about. And then a little bit about Leave No Trace, which is kind of an ethic that we promote in the outdoors to have a minimum impact on the environment. So the Green Mountain Club is who I work for, nonprofit organization in Vermont. Was founded in 1910 by a fellow named James Taylor and a bunch of other people in Burlington. Their goal was to create a trail in the state of Vermont that spanned all the mountains and that went from the Massachusetts border to the Canadian border. They wanted to give everybody in Vermont, regardless of where you were up and down the state, a chance to get out in the mountains and to see see one of the most beautiful pieces of Vermont all up and down the state. Right now, the trail is 272 miles from the Mass border to the Canadian border. Green Mountain Club also maintains 166 miles of side trails, which are the trails that start in a valley or start in a town or at a trailhead and then rise up to meet the Long Trail on the Green Mountain Ridgeline. And then we also have about 25,000 acres of conserved lands where the Long Trail, the side trails exist on. Those are lands that the GMC as an organization has identified as priority for maintaining access to the Long Trail so that it doesn't get sold to somebody else or so that we don't get booted off of it. When the LT was built in 1910 and then until its completion to Canada in 1930, the entire trail was just on private property by handshake agreements by some farmer that said, sure, you can walk through my fields, but that's not really a viable way of land conservation in 2021. So we maintain easements and land conservation agreements with the state and with other organizations on all but 5.5 miles of the long trail at this point. So pretty good feeling to have that done. We also maintain the entire AT in Vermont, so where the Appalachian Trail comes in Massachusetts, and then it separates from Killington and goes east to Norwich and eventually Hanover, New Hampshire, and Mount Katahdin in Maine. So we're responsible for that as well. Some of the programs that you might know of, GMC4 is our caretakers and our trail crew. If you've ever been on top of Mount Mansfield or Camel Sump, you've seen somebody up there shivering in the rain. They are a GMC caretaker. They're doing Alpine Summit stewardship. They're composting human waste at the overnight sites. They're collecting fees from people to support the program that we run. And they're doing basic trail maintenance out on the trails. Our trail crew goes out on the long trail 5 days a week. They enter the woods on a Monday and they don't leave the woods until a Friday. And they do heavy duty trail reconstruction and rehabilitation. So when the long trail was built in 1910 and 1930, it went straight up the side of a mountain and it went straight down the other side of a mountain. People wanted to see the views. They wanted to get there the quickest way possible. Now with climate change, with the 200,000 plus hikers that use the long trail every year, those straight up and down and straight down trails are really bad for trail quality and for erosion. So our trail crew goes out and they take some of those old trails that still exist and they're working on making them more sustainable trails. Trail crew is pictured in the bottom there. Caretakers are on the top. If anyone wants a fall job, we are hiring for fall caretakers and trail crew. We maintain shelters and privies. There's about 70 overnight sites on the long trail. In the bottom left there is Taft Lodge. In the bottom center is Churchill Scott. The top is a new moldering privy, which is wheelchair accessible up to ADA standards. And on the right is what our old privies used to look like. That is a privy with a bed sheet as the cover at Stratton Pond in the 1970s. Without shelters and privies, we would have errant camping and pooping and peeing everywhere. So our overnight sites are designed to concentrate use so that we have more overnight space on the long trail with consequently less of an impact. Taft Lodge can fit 24 people and it's at about 3,800 feet on the side of Mount Mansfield. If we didn't have a building there, then we would have blown out tenting sites everywhere and a really degraded forest. So these are really important parts of what the GMC does. We do trail maintenance and conservation. When trees fall on the long trail, we have to go out and cut them. And as I said in the beginning, conservation, if we didn't have the land to host the long trail as a result of, state of Vermont and federal government down in the national forest, we wouldn't be able to have a trail as we do today. So this is really important work as well. The fellow in the picture there is using a two-person crosscut saw in the Breadloaf Wilderness. There's about 45 miles of long trail that are in wilderness area where we don't use any mechanized equipment whatsoever. So we go back to these primitive tools from the early 1900s. So that's a little bit about the long trail. A really quick overview. If anyone has questions, feel free to put it in the chat. I'll tell you now what maybe qualifies me to talk about this. My name's Lauren. I grew up in Southern Maine, went to college in New Hampshire. And then I was able to spend a couple of years working in New Hampshire in the White Mountains for the Appalachian Mountain Club, and spent a lot of time hiking there. It's where I kind of cut my teeth on what it meant to, go out for these long day hikes, or what it meant to leave for a hike at 4 a.m. Learned what I really needed to have in my backpack and what I didn't. And then I came over to Vermont and I got a position with the Green Mountain Club, supporting organized groups and doing Leave No Trace education. I was able to hike the long trail in 2018. I did a thru-hike from the Canadian border down to the Massachusetts border that took 18 days. It was a really fun time. And it was especially nice to kind of get the reward of working on the long trail for almost 2 years and then getting to take a couple weeks and go out and hike. I like to get out in winter too. I'm not really a winter backpacker. I'd like to be warm when I sleep. But I do go out for long winter day hikes with snowshoes and micro spikes. We won't really focus on winter in this talk, but if anyone has questions about winter hiking, you're looking ahead, then feel free to reach out and we can answer them or ask it in the chat and maybe it'll come up. I'm not really an ultralight hiker. I don't really fit myself into any category, but I like to go to new places. I have kind of my favorite jaunts. I just got a dog, so I love hiking with my dog. If there's questions about that, please let me know. I don't have any kids, so I don't have a lot of insight on hiking with families, but I will try and give a little bit at least. Yeah. If there's any questions, let me know. Learning more. We're not going to cover everything here. There's a lot of content to hiking 101 or intro to hiking, whatever you want to call it. But we do have an organization in Vermont that I just described, the Green Mountain Club, which is the go-to source for hiking information in the state. We maintain over 500 miles of trail with the AT, the LT, all the side trails. And so if there's anything you need to know, if you live somewhere far off in the middle of nowhere and you want to look for a hike, we could probably help you find what that hike is there. We have maps, we have books, we have online maps, we have a really active social media presence, and we have a visitor center that's staffed 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Give them a call, the number's on the bottom there. They can give you any hiking suggestions or information that you might need. So next we're gonna go through a little bit of a difference between maybe walking, hiking, and backpacking. This is a quote that I found: after a day's walk, everything has twice its usual value. I totally agree. Getting out with my dog in the morning just really perks me up. It gets me outside, gets a breath of fresh air before I sit down and start working or before I pack my bag and go to the field. You might differentiate walking between hiking, the activity of going for long walks in the countryside. I tend to think of them as the same. If you can go for a walk through your neighborhood for a couple hours, you can hop off onto a trail and do the same thing. I had a family member that was coming up to visit me when I worked in New Hampshire, and they weren't really a hiker. They were a really active runner. They were really healthy. They were outside all the time. But the person asked me what they should wear for shoes to come up to visit me. And I had to explain, you know, you can wear your running shoes. It'll be fine. They're still going to work. So I would first like to say, break down all biases that we might have about hiking or trails or the woods. Anybody can do it. It's an easy lift. And it just takes a little bit of time and a little bit of thought and patience with ourselves. The next two terms that I really like, one I just learned a couple of months ago, is micro-adventure. So a micro-adventure is an adventure that is short, simple, local, cheap, yet still fun, exciting, challenging, refreshing, and rewarding. So if you get out of work at 5 p.m. and you got nothing planned for the night, go drive to some favorite mountain and go up it, and then come back home, stop and get a creamy for dinner, and go to work the next morning. Like, take those moments of your life that are really special, those beautiful weather days, or that pouring rainstorm, and go out and do something that's going to make it really special. Call up a friend and say, hey, can we go, and get out for the night? I've been doing a lot of these this summer, trying to just forget about a busy season of work and about, other responsibilities in life, and enjoy the moment a little bit. So take those micro adventures and get them whenever you can. And then backpacking. Backpacking is probably something you all have heard of or expect, but there's a long dictionary there, a definition there from Cambridge, but putting all your things on your back that you need and going out in the woods for a couple of days. So relying mostly on yourself to get through. We won't really focus that much on backpacking or these micro adventures, but everything that we talk about tonight will certainly apply to that. Why do you want to go hiking? That's kind of an important question to answer. Nate said in the beginning how hiking can, you can get out, you can clear your mind, you can get exercise, you can breathe some fresh air. In the pandemic, it's been a really nice way to connect with people that you might not know their social distance history. You might not know necessarily what they've been up to and their risk profile versus yours. It's a lot safer to get outside and be with them on a trail, 6 feet apart with the wind blowing and stuff. So that's been a big one for all of us this year. The long trail saw a 35% increased use throughout the pandemic across summits, trails, overnight sites. And that's also with the Canadian border being closed. We estimate that Canadian border being closed is like 30 to 40% of use on summits. And so Vermonters made up for that even being closed. And we had a busier year this year than we've ever had before. So people are getting out at this time, which is really good. And they're seeing the health and the benefits of being on the long trail. For me, it's a way to clear my mind after a day of work. I do think about getting my nature fix. If there's been a span of time where I don't just like sit on a rock on the side of a trail and look at the trees, then I get a little antsy. Enjoying nice weather. If it's a beautiful sunny day and I'm sitting inside for the day, I get bummed. I want to go outside. I want to be there. Again, being with friends, being with dogs, learning about the outdoors, you know, it's a way to observe nature. It's a way to see plants and trees and wildlife I've learned almost everything that I know about Vermont's outdoors by just going on hikes and being interested in stuff. Hiking a long distance trail, somebody in the audience said they were planning on a LT through hike soon, finding a new hobby, or as I like to say, productively procrastinating. I got a lot of work that I should probably be doing this evening, but I'm going to go hiking instead. Take a minute and see if there's anything in the chat there. Great RP, hello from Brattleboro, thanks. Preparing for a thru hike, congratulations. The northeast corner of the Green Mountain State, there's lots of great trails in the Northeast Kingdom. We have a map called the Northeast Kingdom Trail Map. It's really good, got almost everything on there. And you should join the Northeast Kingdom section, which is a great way to learn more. And then yeah, from Burlington, lots of good stuff right around Burlington. Burlington Wildways is a really neat organization connecting our wild spaces in Burlington with a central trail. This slide shows you that hiking can be hard. That big ladder there is on the side of Mount Hunger. Those rocks are part of a staircase that you got to climb up on the long trail. And then that's the summit of Jay Peak. Jay Peak is one of the most relentless climbs on the LT. I don't think I've ever heard anybody say they had fun hiking Jay Peak, but it's beautiful. And so depending on where you go in the state, it can be really challenging. You want to know that before you go. We'll talk a little bit about how to learn that stuff. But if you're getting out for an LT thru hike, be prepared. Some places are pretty hard. It can also be really easy. That picture on the right there is on the long trail, an old forest road that you walk for a little bit. The center, you see the white blaze, that's the Appalachian Trail in Vermont. And then on the left is just me and my dog right behind the GMC's headquarters in Waterbury Center on our little short trail. So there's a big scale in where you might want to go. If you're looking for a two-night overnight, or if you're looking just to get started hiking, then go towards the easier side. Do some research, find out what's an easy trail, and work your way up to the harder things. A first-time hiker probably wouldn't be the best thing to go and do a 7-mile ascent up Mount Mansfield, but getting out to Mount Mansfield State Forest and taking on some of the lower elevation trails that kind of wind around, or going to Camel's Hump and doing the Camel's Hump View Trail is a lot better than going all the way up and down Camel's Hump in your first outing. So that's to say, anybody can go hiking, just got to go to the right place. Related to that is, how do you get ready for those things? When I went out for an 18-day long trail through hike, I'd been working for the GMC all summer long. So I was very used to having a heavy backpack on, carrying tools and equipment, spending nights in the woods. But that's not everybody's life. And that's certainly not my life right now even. So if I was to go out for a long trail through hike, or even if I was to try and do a big long, 12-mile day in the woods, I would want to think about, where am I going? How hard is it going to be? And then most importantly, is my body ready for this? We should find the hike to match our body, not make our body match the hike. So the four things to focus on are increasing your major muscle strength. So everything when we go hiking is our quads, our glutes, our abs, and then, shoulders, upper, lower back, and your big muscle units. So if you think about that stuff, do push-ups, do squats, do those big body things that you see these massive football players doing in the gym. Just do it with no weights at all and get used to doing it. Then we want to build endurance. So we want to do that more and more and more. We want to do more of those no weight squats. We want to go out for longer walks. We want to keep on doing those things when we're a little bit tired. It's really important to kind of stress yourself just a little tiny bit. Aerobic activities relates to, get on a bicycle every once in a while, or go to a yoga class, or go for a walk that makes you break a sweat. Really anything that can make you break a sweat, you can think of as an aerobic activity. And then balance. Balance is really important. If we go back to this trail, these rocks, these step ladders, if you can't balance on those things, then you could be the bulkiest, beefiest, strongest person in the world, but balance is really important. So that's where yoga, calisthenics, all kinds of stuff like that really comes in handy. And then most of all, if you want to get in physical fitness for hiking shape, go hiking. Find small trails near you. Start really slow, start really easy, and build up. It's also important to wear a backpack. A lot of people are not used to wearing a backpack with, 10 or 15 pounds in it. And that can be really hard. So if you're going out for a little hike or for a little jaunt, or if you're walking through the neighborhood, put a backpack on and throw in the stuff that you're actually going to need, some water, some snacks. maybe a board game, maybe a book, so that you get used to having your backpack on and used to feeling that additional weight. And then last, if something feels like it's hurting, modify what you're doing or stop. I've had hiking injuries that put me out for a month, and it's really a bummer. So definitely take it slow, take it easy. Again, everybody gets there. I was not a hiker. I was not an active person as a kid. And then I started doing that, and it's been really nice. If you talk about where to go hiking, here are some of the things that we want to consider. Hiking distance, so how long is this? Is this going to be a mile, or is this going to be 3 miles or 7 miles? How far do you have to drive? For me, I have a couple of trails right near my house that are really easy to get to. Those are the ones that I go to the most. They're the ones that I care the most about. They're the ones that I really couldn't live without. So think about when you're planning your training, or when you're planning getting ready to become a hiker, how easy is it for you to get where you want to go, and prioritize those easy ones because you're going to do them more often. Parking is a big one. The Long Trail, Mount Mansfield, Camel's Hump can be really busy on Saturdays and Sundays. You want to think about, is there space for my car there on a Saturday morning at 10 a.m.? Related to that, how busy is your trail? What do you want to experience on that day? Elevation gain or loss. We could all probably go out and walk 6 miles on a flat, dirt, gravel surface. But if that's 6 miles up and down and up and down, that's going to be a lot different. So we want to look at a map. We want to read a guidebook and understand how much gain and loss is there in this hike. Terrain, is it rocky? Is it slippery? Is it muddy? Is it an old railroad bed? Related to that, trail features and characteristics. There's a couple places in Vermont where there's big rocks you get to pass by. There's waterfalls, there's bridges. All that kind of stuff is going to influence how good that hike is. Your own personal goals on that day or on that month or on that year. For me this afternoon, I want to get out. I want to break sweat. I want to, feel like I've done something with my day. There might be other days where I'm meeting up with a friend and I want to just chat with them and reconnect. I'm going to pick different things depending on those days. Seasonal conditions. In Vermont, we have mud season. I'm sure you all have heard of that. We also have black fly season. We have mosquito season. We have horse fly season. So think about where you're going, about what you're going to encounter. And then trail restrictions. We have peregrine falcons in Vermont. Mud season closes a lot of trails. So it's responsible to check on those things and get to know them a little bit. If you have any questions about this, or if you want to share a favorite trail or a local park in the chat, it'd be great to learn a little bit about where your folks are all getting out to. Here's a couple hard and fast resources for where to go hiking. So the Long Trail in Vermont, as I said, there's about 500 miles of hiking trails that the GMC maintains. State of Vermont Fish and Wildlife has some areas called wildlife management areas. A lot of them have trails in them. There's like over 100 wildlife management areas spread throughout the state. They're really, really good ways to find something local, quick and easy that is not busy. People don't really go to them very often. They're beautiful. Check out your local wildlife management area and check out what the state has to offer there. On the right there is a map of all of Vermont state parks. As you can see, they're everywhere. They all have some type of trail or walking opportunity. Check that out. And then trailfinder.info is a website made by Upper Valley Trails Alliance, Community GIS. They have a lot of really good resources on just finding local trail systems. So say you're going to meet a friend somewhere in Southern Vermont that you've never been to before and you want to go for a walk. Trail Finder is a really good way to load up the website, see where you're going, see what the options are. They also communicate with the trail managers. So if it's a GMC trail, they will have talked to the GMC about the posting, about what should be on that posting, about what to learn there. So it's also one of the most reliable resources of information. All trails, a lot of people use All Trails. I'm not gonna harsh on All Trails, but All Trails doesn't really talk to the trail maintainers or the organizations. Trail Finder does. So you get a lot more reliable information from Trail Finder. Lastly, GMC started a couple years ago a campaign called Hike VT. Love GMC. Our goal is to share with people all the opportunities that exist for hiking in Vermont and kind of what the GMC does to support that. So go to the website on the bottom there, greenmountainclub.org/hikevt, and you will see endless options for hiking trails in Vermont, whether it's a long distance hike, like 2 or 3 days, or it's an easy 1.5 to 2 hour little jaunt in your backyard. Lots of good options there from Hike VT. And we publish and maintain those pretty much weekly. Couple of my favorites, Mountain of Scutney, the Ice Beds Trail in Wallingford. If anyone's down near Wallingford area, Ice Bedge Trail is this big, big rock fall, and you get to walk all the way down to the bottom of it. It'll be, you know, 75 degrees in Rutland, but then you go to Wallingford Ice Bedge Trail, it's like 37 down there. It's really cool. And then the Lamoille Valley Rail Trail is a great way to get out for a walk, use the bike, do anything, get your heart rate up. Talk a little bit about the differences between group, solo, and family hiking. Some of this goes without saying, but it's important to consider. If this is your first time in Vermont, maybe you just moved here, maybe you haven't been on a hike before, you're gonna wanna pick something different if you're going by yourself than if you're going with a group. If you're going with a group, if you know the group, if you trust the group, if you've talked back and forth about your goals and your decisions and kind of had a little pre-hike meeting, you probably could do something a little bit tougher. I started telemark skiing a couple of years ago and I'm not good, but when I'm with friends that are good skiers, I'm a much better skier because it just gets me excited. It gets me amped up and I feel like I need to show up for that. And that's kind of what going out with a group can do as well. It pushes us a little bit farther. Again, solo hiking, if you get out of work and it's 5 p.m. and you want to go do that little individual micro adventure, it's good to be prepared for that stuff as well. And then getting out with your family, getting out with your friends is awesome to do. Like I said in the beginning, I don't have kids, but I do have two little nieces that are about 8 and 5. And as the uncle that gets outside, I'm really excited to have those moments with them when we're off in the woods together. And it's a great way to connect with family or long lost friends that you haven't seen in a while to say, hey, I got this trail. Want to go out for a little walk with me? I'll handle everything for you. Next, we'll dive into a couple quick tips on what it means to go hiking as a family. So this picture on the left here is the Higgins family. They are the adopters of the long trail from Route 108 up to Taft Lodge. That's about 2 miles. So they're volunteers for the Green Mountain Club. One of the ways that they get out as a family is they volunteer. So reach out to your local trail organization, reach out to the GMC and see what we could do for you as a family to volunteer. And then on the right there is one of my coworkers' kids. They get out all the time. They're really fun. I know that they are also terrors and that sometimes they have sat on a rock and refused to move. So you can get anything when you go out, but a couple tips to get through anything is go somewhere fun, moderate your expectations. So if you as an adult want to do 6 miles, Zed got 3 kids with you, you're probably not going to do 6 miles. Come up with some games and activities. Think about things that could be fun for a kid to do on that hike that will keep them energized, that will, you know, kind of fight off exhaustion and make them excited to take another step each time. Bringing friends. I've seen, a parent and their kid, and the kid just is bored of the parent, isn't excited, doesn't get pushed. Bring a couple friends and make it an activity for that kid. Make it something that's really fun for them. Make it like they're, you know, sitting on the couch watching movies, but really they're on the trail hiking. Give them a pack to carry. It's really important that, you know, people feel like they have a purpose. Even if it's a backpack with just like a couple fruit roll-ups and some water, that's going to give them some autonomy over when do they stop for water? When do they want a snack? What kind of stuff do they want to bring with them? If they're cold, do they put on another layer? If they're hot, do they take it off? And then rewards and rewards and rewards. Stop for creamies. I know people that learn to hike as kids by their parents laying M&Ms out way ahead of them. So they have to chase each M&M up and down the trail. So just think about all those things that would make it fun for a child. If you have any questions on this, we have a lot of staff that are kids, that have kids at GMC. Somebody is actually heading off on a month-long vacation to hike the long trail with his 7-year-old, his 12-year-old, and his 14-year-old. So he's going to be in for quite the time, and we'll have a lot of tips and tricks to share, I'm sure. Transitioning again to weather. Sorry, we're kind of jumping around all over the place, but there's a lot to cover. Like I said, weather is a really important feature. Today is kind of a good example of a Vermont summer day. It poured at my house earlier and was pretty windy and cold. Now we got bright blue skies, still some big clouds up there. But I generally would be a little concerned about going on a hike today. We've had kind of an unstable weather pattern for a while, some thunderstorms, some lots of rain last week. I know Southern Vermont is getting slammed with rain this week as well. So for weather, we want to think about where you're going, not your home. So if you live in Burlington, but you're going to go hiking in Killington, check the weather for Killington. Hikes are weather dependent. There are a lot of hikes in Vermont that I wouldn't do in a lightning storm. But then there are a lot of other hikes where I feel pretty fine walking through the woods with some thunder and lightning around me. So check where you're going. Think about the terrain. Think about the exposure. Think about the time of year, the season. All those things kind of play into it. Pack what's needed. At the bottom, I say there's no bad weather, only bad preparation. So expect the unexpected with your weather. And then know the previous weather. That relates mostly to rainfall. So if it poured as it did last Thursday and Friday, then you want to go on a hike that has a lot of stream crossings. You might want to rethink that because those stream crossings are going to be really high. Watch out for the Arnold Schwarzenegger of clouds. Tall with a hard body means developing a storm. So these big thunder clouds that sometimes you see on the highway when you're driving along, you got this big open sky. That's a thunder cloud. Cumulonimbus, I think they call them. And try and check the weather often, get an idea of what it's like. Check the weather and then keep an eye on what's going on outside for a little while so you know what to expect. NOAA, Weather Underground, Mountain Forecast are all really good. And then you want to know if you're going for a hike in September and you plan on leaving at 3 p.m., that's going to be different than going for a hike in July and leaving at 3 p.m. So always have a general idea of when the sunrise and the sunset is so that we can be ready for whatever you might want to do. If you're in New Hampshire or if you're planning a hike in New England in general to a higher summit, so anywhere that's exposed, the Mount Washington Observatory also provides a really, really good mountain forecast. It's central for the New Hampshire region and for the White Mountains, but it's a really good way to get an idea of what mountain forecasts are and what to expect. They also contrast it to the valley forecast. So it's nice to be able to look at a mountain forecast and see it's going to be 35 degrees and blowing 70 miles an hour, and then look at the valley forecast and see it's 55 and calm. So mountain weather is really, really different. You want to prepare for that if you plan on, you know, getting up in elevation. We're going to jump to layers. Like I said, there's no bad weather, only bad preparation. So folks, if you have audio on your computer, I encourage you to turn that up a little bit. We'll play a little video from REI. Yeah.
It doesn't matter what the weather's like or what season you're hiking in.
Oops, how did that happen? Oh, that's a bummer.
Your basic backpack and clothes stay the same. When the sun's shining and the birds are chirping, a non-cotton wicking base layer may be all you need. When the leaves start changing and the snow flurries hit, it's time to add your warm, insulating mid-layer. And for torrential downpours, windy ridges, or just a light rain, you'll be glad you packed your shell layer. So there you have it. No matter where you go or when you head out, make sure you bring your base layer, your mid-layer, and your shell.
So that's a really quick overview of the basics of packing for a hike with your clothing. Even if you're going out just for a couple hours, you might not know what the weather's gonna do. You wanna bring that stuff so that you're prepared. So you need a base layer, a mid layer, and a shell layer. An acronym that I use is WISE. So you have your wicking layer, your insulating layer, your shell layer, and then any extras. So the wicking is what pulls moisture and sweat away from your skin, doesn't let it sit there on your skin, which would then make you cold. The insulating keeps all that radiation that comes out of your body within you. So our bodies produce a lot of heat. If it's really cold out, then you need that insulating layer to keep your heat in. And then the shell is for wind and for rain. You can see this little diagram here of the ways that our body loses heat. So convection is prevented by our shell. Radiation loss is prevented by our insulating layer. Conduction is prevented by all three of them. And then evaporation is prevented by the wicking. So that system I use everywhere. Even if it's a nice summer day, if I'm going out, then I will have some amount of those three things. I have a really light shell. It's super paper thin. I use it for trail running. I bring that with me almost every single time I go. And then an insulating layer can be as simple as just a thicker base layer. It can be a merino wool, a thicker base layer if it's a really hot day, but you should always bring an extra piece. Some of the other items of clothing that you want to think about are an extra base layer. So if I'm booking it up a mountain and I got a short sleeve t-shirt on, and I'm sweating really hard, then that's going to get really wet. And then when I wait, I have a snack at the top, I turn around, maybe the sun goes around the other side of the mountain and the temperature stops to drop a little bit. You want to have a base layer to change into for later on. Extra socks are always good. A buff, which is kind of like a neck gaiter. Warm hat, warm gloves, ankle gaiters prevent mud from getting in your boots and on your socks and stuff. They can keep your feet a little bit drier. And then a baseball cap if you're, you know, if you're getting up above the trees or if it's really sunny out. A couple of layers that I brought to show people. This, let's see. This is a synthetic down jacket. I bought this from L.L. Bean 6 years ago. Got a lot of holes in it. I patched them all. I suggest synthetic down for hiking in Vermont sometimes. This just stays warm even when it gets wet. If you're using regular down will lose all of its insulating qualities when it gets wet. So synthetic down is a good item. Another good insulating layers on there, fleece, wool, even a wool sweater will do a good job for you. And then if I'm hiking in the summer, I just wear running shorts. I wear just basic, simple running shorts, like gym shorts, whatever you got, anything works that's light, that's breathable, that's comfortable to wear. If it's a colder summer day, or if I'm hiking in the spring or in the fall, then I have this pair of synthetic hiking pants. These ones are made by Patagonia. They have a good waistband that cinches. They have nice slim pockets. They allow for a good range of movement. So thinking about, you know, what your bottom layer is really important. If it's cold and you don't want to buy these fancy pants, then just wear simple leggings or simple long johns that are synthetic under your running shorts, under your gym shorts. You can get all that for $20 at any store, and it gets the job done. If anyone has questions on layers, I'll take a look at the chat. Great. Water is important. We all drink water. We sweat when we hike. Key things with water. I think a lot of this goes without saying, but don't drink unpurified water. Anywhere in Vermont, we don't suggest it. You should purify all your water. Even if it's a spring that you really trust, there's no harm in putting it through a filter. If you are going out for a long time, if you have a hike that you plan to be, you know, 8 hours, if you plan to go through all of your water and you don't know if you're going to be stopping by water sources, buying a little tab of a little box of Aquamira, which is chlorine tablets, is really, really easy. It's super lightweight. Keep it in your backpack. Don't ever take it out, and you'll always have it if you need it. It's really unpleasant to be dehydrated on a hike. So you want to be able to get more water. I use a Sawyer filter. These are, really, really well-known, really common for everybody from a simple trail runner that's going out for a couple hours to a long distance through hiker on the Appalachian Trail. You can hook it up to these little bags that they give you, or you can just take any basic liter water bottle and cap this on it. And then you got, you always got good water in your backpack. I avoid caffeine and alcohol. They dehydrate you. Alcohol impairs your thinking and your judgment, which you don't want when you're on a hike. And then if it's really cold out, a tea and hot cocoa make a huge difference on a cold fall hike where it's windy. They really warm up your body. I like black licorice flavored teas. And then on a hot day, bringing along a cold ice thing of Gatorade, or even just a Gatorade packet, getting water straight from a stream, filtering it, it's really cold, mixing some Gatorade, keeps you moving, gives you some sugar. Also, Nalgene's are, you know, an invaluable water bottle. I'm no fan of all these other water bottles that exist. I will never not use Nalgene's. Food is important. Food is the fuel that runs our body. Hiking food for a day hike is really no different than food that you might want to have. If you're going to work for the day and you need to pack a lunch, you can probably pack similar things to what you're bringing hiking for just a day hike. If you're going on an overnight hike, if you're going for a backpacking trip, food becomes a lot different, becomes a lot more important. The way that you pack it, the way that you store it, the way that you manage it. But if you're just going out for the day, think about, you know, those regular things. Peanut butter and jelly, bagel sandwiches and wraps are really good. They don't get crushed in your backpack. And you can secure them really well. Energy bars, trail bars, I'm a big fan of apples and veggie sticks and a bar of cheese. I'm also a big fan of going to the store and buying a baguette and a block of cheese and some salami or pepperoni or something. And then you got this, you know, feel like a fancy king in the woods. If anyone has questions on food, let me know. Bring more, always bring a little bit extra. I always have an extra bar or two in my backpack in case I run late or in case something terrible happens and I get stuck in the woods. Same thing as water. It's one of those things that we never want to be without. It's easy to not be without it. It's easy to stuff a couple extra things in your bag. Other ones that I like a lot are, I found these little applesauce packets a couple of weeks ago. They're really wonderful. I have a little screw top. And those are just like a quick shot of sugar to you. Oh, and maple syrup is really good. Take a small squeeze bottle and fill it with maple syrup. It tastes great on a mountain. So food and water and layers are three of the 10 essentials that we should always bring with us hiking. You see it there, food and extra food, water, layers and extra layers. The other ones, we're not going to get into them all. Navigation, headlamp, sun protection, first aid, a knife, fire starter, and then shelter. So navigation, having a map and compass. Don't rely on your cell phone. Cell phone batteries die. If you need to use your cell phone, you want to be using that cell phone for maybe an emergency call. So if you're spending the entire time on all trails or on Gaia, looking at your phone, making sure you're going the right way, that phone battery is going to die. And then say your friend falls and breaks an ankle, you're not going to have a phone battery to call for help in that unfortunate situation. So bring a map, bring a compass, know how to use them. Don't rely on technology or your cell phones. They're good to have, but we can't rely on them. A headlamp with extra batteries. Always check the batteries. Make sure they're good before you leave. I put a headlamp in my backpack, ran out for a hike, and then check it later, and it's dead. Luckily, I get home in time, but that would do me no good. Sun protection. Even if you think you're going to be in the woods, bring some sunscreen. If you think you're going to be above tree line, if you're going to hike Mount Mansfield for the first time, sunglasses, sunscreen, a hat are really good. The sun can be pretty blinding up above the trees. That's especially true in winter if it's a sunny day because the snow reflects all that light. First aid, always have a small first aid kit. Know how to use it. If you want information on wilderness first aid classes, let me know. Knife, fire starter, and then a shelter. A shelter is something that I would call an emergency bivy sack. So that little person all curdled up there in that little orange thing, like what you see people wearing after they run a marathon. Those are, again, one of those things. Put in your backpack, never take it out. It's always there if you need it. So if you get stuck out late at night, something happens, you can prepare yourself. We want to think about the 10 essentials as what are the things that I will absolutely need if I have to spend the night in the woods. Additional niceties are a bug net for your head, bug spray, trekking poles. A lot of people like trekking poles. They are good for your knees. They make trekking a little bit easier. One small tip with trekking poles, you can buy this little rubber cap that goes on the end. I can show you there. That's a little cap that goes on the end of your trekking poles. The end of trekking poles are really, really sharp. They're a carbide tip designed to grab onto rocks. However, if you're hiking in the woods and you have these carbide tips posting into the side of the trail all the time, we have a lot of trail degradation from those. So buying a pair of these little rubber tips for $9 and putting them on both your poles when you're below tree line and when you don't need to be grabbing onto rocks does a really good thing to save the sides of the trail. If you're out on a hike, notice it. You'll see all these little tiny, tiny pokey holes in the side of the trail. That's from trekking poles. And that's bad for the vegetation and bad for erosion on the side of the trail. And then a camera and a charged cell phone. Again, don't rely on it, but having a charged cell phone when you go in the woods is a smart thing to do. For footwear, our feet are our most important way to get out. Feet are really gross, especially if you're going out on a long distance hike. So we want to take extremely good care of our feet. That picture on the left there is a GMC volunteer that has hiked the Long Trail 3 times. He did give me permission to show a picture of his feet. But we want to take good care of our feet. So we avoid blisters by avoiding pressure, heat, and moisture in our feet. If you have a spot of your shoe that's rubbing on your foot continuously over and over again, that's going to make that part of the foot really hot. It's going to have a lot of pressure. And then you're also hiking in the middle of summer. So your feet are going to get wet. Or you're going to go through a stream. So your feet are going to get wet. It's okay to have wet feet, but it's not okay to have wet feet with pressure and heat. You get that situation with new shoes or with new boots that you haven't broken in, or that your feet aren't used to, or that don't fit well. So the solutions are getting a good fit for your shoes, getting a good fit for your socks, reducing any movement or any slippage or any pressure in your shoes. The number one thing with blisters is if you feel them, stop and treat them. You treat them by putting some moleskin or some duct tape or anything over the place that's rubbing to protect your skin a little bit more. Blisters are not bad when you first feel them. When you first feel a hot spot, it's okay. But when you continue hiking for 3 miles and it continues rubbing every single step there, you're going to get really, really, really uncomfortable blisters. And then you're not going to be able to walk for a little while. So treat your blisters before they become blisters. Oh, and then the type of footwear. I suggest what is that brown boot looking thing for most people if you're new to hiking. You can wear really big, beefy leather mountaineering boots like that on the left, or you can wear Chacos on the right, or you can wear trail runners. Most thru-hikers wear trail runners nowadays, but boots are really good as well. They provide a little bit more support. If you're not used to rocks and muddy trails and steep climbs, then a mid-level hiking boot is a good call. We need a backpack. Backpacks are super essential. That's how we carry all of our things. Backpacks are one of those gear junky pieces. You could search the web for days and never see the same backpack again. Get something that works. Get something that feels good on your back, that carries everything that you need. Practice with it. Give it a try. Go to a store. A lot of people buy things online nowadays. You don't know how that's going to fit. Go to your Outdoor Gear Exchange or Onion River Sports in Montpelier and try on a bag and see how it goes. Talk to them, let them fit you to it, and make sure that's the right one. If it's not the right one, then figure out why, return it. Backpacks are super important. I use an Osprey, it's 48 liters for big, long overnight winter hikes. I really like it. I've had it for 7 years. It's got lots of holes in it. I'm probably gonna replace it soon. This is a bag that I use in every single long summer hike and then a winter hike as well. For a general day hike in the summertime, anywhere from 20 to 40 liters should suffice. If you're going out in the winter, you wanna be probably 40 liters up. And then that's a little diagram there on how to pack your gear if you're going for multiple days. Still applies to a small day hike with lots of stuff. We're going to talk a little bit about leave no trace. Leave no trace, like I said in the beginning, is this principle of outdoor ethics, kind of a way that we act to be respectful to the outdoors and to the environment and to the trail when we're out there. Like I said, there's over 200,000 people that step foot on the Long Trail every year, and every one of them has an impact. But with some really basic principles of reducing your impact, we can continue to welcome people to the Long Trail without having a continued degradation of the trail. If Mount Mansfield had, you know, none of its pretty flowers on it, or if there weren't trees next to the trail, it probably wouldn't be as pretty. So it's really important that we all think about our cumulative impact on the outdoors and then our also singular impact so that we can preserve it for future generations. This is a really cute little video. I'm gonna play it. Turn your volume on again.
Number one, know before you go.
Number two, choose the right path.
Number three, trash your trash.
Number four, leave what you find.
Number five, be careful with fire.
Respect wildlife.
Number seven,
so those kids are telling it like it is. If you do those seven things, we can continue welcoming people to the trail and also learn some really cool hand signals. We'll go through some of those really quickly so you get a gist of what you need to do when you get out there. Leave No Trace New Zealand is an amazing YouTube page with really fun videos of each principle of Leave No Trace. I encourage you to check it out. And I encourage you, if you're a little bit interested, to do some research. There's some really interesting research on how should we educate people about their impact on the outdoors for the greatest benefit. So principle number three, trash your trash, also known as dispose of waste properly. the number one thing there for a lot of people is peeing and pooping. So if you're off on the long trail or if you're on a day hike and you need to go pee, you should go 200 feet from the trail or as far away from the trail as you need to go to not really impact other people. You should go far from water sources, again, 200 feet. If you need to, you know, I don't always go 200 feet. If I'm just taking a quick pee, I'm on a not quiet trail. But if you're on a really busy trail and you need to go, it's nice to be respectful of others and not show them your butt. So that's going pee. If you need to go poop, then you should use a Green Mountain Club privy. There are 70 of them on the long trail. And if you get to a trailhead, you know, do your research, know what trailhead you're going to, know if there's a privy coming up, or go at home. If you don't have a privy near there, then the proper thing to do is to dig a cat hole if you're going poop. And we dig cat holes using a trowel and I don't know where my trowel went. Using a trowel and digging a 6 to 8 inch deep hole, doing your business in there. These two leaves on the bottom here, striped maple and hobble bush, are really, really good woods toilet paper. There's lots of it. It's everywhere. So learn how to identify striped maple and hobble bush. Use that as your toilet paper. Save a roll of toilet paper. And then mix it all up in the hole. Cover the hole again. Make sure you go 200 feet from any water, 200 feet from any trail, 200 feet from any other feature, really. If everybody used cat holes in the woods, we'd be in big trouble. But a couple cat holes when people can't get to a privy is generally okay. There's also great videos online of how to dig a cat hole. Trash and wildlife. A lot of people like to toss their apple core or their banana peel. Those things do not decompose in a mountain environment the same way that they do in your backyard garden compost. So if you carried in a banana and you ate the banana and then you're gonna keep on hiking out, your backpack is going to be lighter. I don't really understand, like there's no reason to throw that thing when you could put it back in your backpack and it'll be a little bit lighter. And if we think about it, if everybody threw their banana or their apple peel, we'd have bananas and apple cores all over the mountains. And we would also have a lot of problems from nuisance wildlife. Bears are a problem on the long trail in Vermont. We've already had a number of problem incidents this year where hikers didn't store their food properly. Bears got food, they got habituated to the food. Chipmunks, everything else is an impact. You might say, well, it's Vermont, apples grow in Vermont, but they don't really grow on the side of Mount Mansfield. So if you bring something in, bring it out with you. If you're hiking with dogs, keep your dog on the leash. Dogs will get off into other wildlife areas and could have an impact on a breeding season or on wildlife trying to find food or on some young nesting. So keeping your dog on leash and under control is really important for wildlife benefits. That picture there is of some pistachios on the top of Mount Mansfield. Pistachios are not gonna rot on the top of a mountain. They're just gonna stay there or they'll get blown away. So those little things make a difference. Eggshells is something that we find all the time. So if you pack it in with you, pack it out with you. And then the Snickers bar is shown because our candy bars, our energy bars like that, they have little tiny wrappers and little tiny peels. And frequently we're hiking along, we're tired, we're hungry. We peel off that wrapper and then a portion of that wrapper falls on the ground. That's what we call micro trash. Micro trash exists all over the trails and we want to do our part to reduce that by thinking about what each item that we bring in the woods is and how it's wrapped. If you're a Snickers person and you want to eat 3 Snickers on a hike, unwrap those Snickers at home, put them in a Ziploc bag and carry that out so you don't lose that Snickers bar wrapper when you're off in the woods. This all applies for a long distance hike too. Packaging and preparing your food is really important. Travel on durable surfaces is this symbol number 2, where you take your 2 fingers and you walk on a durable surface. The 2 most important things here in the state of Vermont are to do the rock walk above treeline and in alpine zones. Alpine plants in Vermont are they're a remnant of the glacial period. They're what it used to look like right after glaciers left and we were just repopulating our mountains. They're really, really special plants too. There are plants that grow on Vermont's mountains, Mount Mansfield, Camel Stump, and Mount Abe, that don't grow anywhere else in the state. And there's plants here that don't grow anywhere else in the world. So a couple footsteps will really kill these special plants that have adapted to live above the treeline. So if you're up there, you're gonna see string lining the side of the trail. Stay within the string, walk only on the rocks, and try and think about each footstep having a consequent impact. The other picture there is mud. Mud in Vermont is a problem. rains a lot, we have wet soils. So if you're hiking along the trail and you see mud, you might think that you want to avoid that mud because you want to keep your feet dry. But as you can see in this picture, people have been avoiding that mud a lot by going to the sides of the trail. And as they go to the sides of the trail, they're stepping on the vegetation that's actually holding the sides of the trail in place. That vegetation is dying. And then the sides of the trail are eroding into the mud pit. So by stepping to the side of the trail, we're actually worsening the problem and we're creating a bigger and deeper and more impactful mud pit. And then the problem just exacerbates itself because people continue to go around the mud pit. So if you're hiking on the long trail or anywhere in Vermont or in New Hampshire or in Maine for that matter, the best thing to do is to walk right through the mud, to have on footwear that you're okay with getting muddy, to wear your ankle gaiters and to enjoy doing the right thing for the trail. Every single footstep around the mud is another problem that the trail crews go out to work on. There might be step stones in the trail, there might be punching or bog bridging, you can step on those things to keep your feet dry. And then, the last one of those principles of Leave No Trace that we'll talk about is be considerate of others, which is waving in a peace sign. If you do this and if you plan ahead and prepare, so if you look at your hike, if you know where you're going, if you know what the weather's gonna be, if you know where the privy is, if you know if there's a dog restriction, if you know that your headlamp is charged and that you have enough food, you do all that planning and that preparing. And then if you go out and if you're just really, really considerate of what's going on out there and what your impacts are, if you think about each footstep and the trail crew that's going to have to work on the trail, if you think about each other person and how maybe it could be their very first hike and they don't have a backpack on or they're wearing flip-flops or something, say something nice to them and be friendly on the trail. Everybody's new at some point. So say hi, give people space to pass if you're hiking along and they look really tired or they're cruising a lot faster than you. There are some rules about who has the right of way on trails. I generally just communicate with people. And if I'm tired and if I want to take a break, then I step off. Or if they step off first, then I keep going. I don't really abide by too many of those right of way trail rules. Music, if you're listening to music on the trail, if you want to put it on a speaker, just keep it quiet enough that if somebody's coming up behind you, you can hear them. Or if somebody's coming down the trail ahead of you, they're not hearing you from a quarter mile away. So keep it at an indoor volume if you're really outside, or wear headphones. Think about if you're going as a group. If you're going as a group of 15 friends, you're gonna be louder. There's gonna be more of you. You're gonna spread out on the trail occasionally. You're gonna have an impact on that one person that's getting out after work for some solace and some individual time. So think about what your activities are like a group as opposed to yourself. And then again, follow the other Leave No Trace principles. If you are interested in learning more, then like I said in the beginning, the Green Mountain Club is a great place to go to learn more hiking information. We have a really, really active Facebook group called Long Trail Hiking GMC Community. We moderate that, but generally it's all information that's spurred on by the general public. So if you're looking to plan a long trail through hike and you want to get advice, you can go there and you can find almost anything that people have asked about if you scroll through. There's a lot of good information in that group, and it's all crowdsourced from people that are out there on the trail. And it's also moderated by GMC, so you're getting good stuff. Give the club a call, the number's there, and our email is a general help email. You send that to them and they'll get back to you right away with suggestions and answers and stuff. And then if you're looking for a group hike, or if you wanna get out and learn some tips and tricks from other people, the GMC has these things called sections. They're these volunteer membership gatherings. So if you join the Green Mountain Club, which is a $45 individual membership for a year, and then we also have a family membership and we have an under 30 membership. If you join the Green Mountain Club, you get to elect to be a part of a section. And those sections are ways to meet other people. They're a way to support the activities and the trail maintenance that section does. Each section hosts a bunch of social hikes every year. So that calendar is all the hikes going on. So if you want to go hiking every single day of the week with a bunch of really educated, really smart people who are super kind and going to give you tips and tricks, the GMC's calendar of events and outings is a good way to find new hikes, find new people, make some friends, and get out there. When I moved to Vermont, I didn't have any friends at all. And then I started working for the Green Mountain Club and doing trail work and meeting volunteers and going on these hikes. And it's a really great way to get out and learn a bunch of stuff. One of those on there, July 11th, unfortunately, it passed already. Layerway Lookout, I'm a really big fan of, and Little Rock Pond. So lots of good hikes out there. that's my presentation, folks. That's my dog, Otto. You might have seen him in some of the pictures up on a ski trail. So been really fun to get out with him. We were scouting some trail work in this picture, and I brought him along on a Monday morning. But I can take a look at the chat, or Nate, if anything came in during that time, glad to answer it. Oh, yeah, I'll also put my email in there. So if folks have questions, or if I said anything that you disagree with, if you want to get into a tizzy, let me know. That's my email. And then, yeah, the GMC's general email is gmc@greenmountainclub.org. And then our helpline, our front desk, is in there as well.
Beautiful. Oh, thank you, Lauren, so much. I know I took a whole bunch of notes, and really appreciate this. This is such a treat to get this great presentation. So I just want to thank you from myself and from COVID Support Vermont. And thank you. Thanks to everyone who's watching now, everyone that was here, everyone that's going to watch this on the replay, the recording. We will make this recording available if you want to go back and check out some of the things and see that again. We'll also have a PDF we'll put up of the slides, so you can have access to that. I'm just putting in the chat the link for the Green Mountain Club. So if you scroll up, it's in there. I put the Trail Finder link there, as well as our COVID support vt.org. If you can find out about more of our events, we have a lot of great recommendations and resources for all kinds of wellness things and our other things coming up. And so, Lauren, thank you so much. Thank you, Green Mountain Club, and thanks everyone for coming. Absolutely, it's fantastic.
Yeah, thank you, Nate. Appreciate the invitation. And again, folks, just general message, get out there, give it a try, have fun. Vermont's a good place to be. So yeah, thanks again.
Wonderful.
Good.
Wonderful.
Have a good night, Nate.
All right, you too. Thank you so much, Lauren. Take care, everyone. Have a great night.